What is RSS and why should I care? Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. Ask Leo is brought to you in part by the support of my patrons. If you are one, thank you. If you're not, visit askleo.com/patron to find out more, how you can help and get access to patron exclusive content. RSS, which I mentioned in a recent article, is a technology that actually makes information publishing very, very easy and adds a lot of power to it. In fact, if you listen to podcasts, you're probably already using it, surprisingly enough. The issue is that RSS itself, which is something like a couple of decades old at least, never really caught on in the mainstream, but it is still used widely by a lot of websites and a lot of more knowledgeable consumers. What I want to do is talk about exactly what it is and how you might be able to use it as a way to get information from the websites and services that you care about, including Ask Leo. So it all starts with a feed. In order to support RSS, a website will provide what's called a feed. A feed is nothing more than a specially formatted file that contains information about each of the most recent articles that have been published on that site. That's actually all it really is. Let's have a look at Ask Leo's feed. The Ask Leo feed, the RSS feed for Ask Leo, is at askleo.com/feed. That turns out to be the default feed for pretty much any website that happens to be implemented using WordPress, as Ask Leo is. If you take a look at that page, if you take a look at that file, what results is a bunch of what probably looks like unintelligible gibberish. It is, in fact, a specially formatted file. It is in XML format, extensible markup language, extended to or customized to provide information in a structured way. What it includes is information about the channel, what they call the channel, or in this case, the site, askleo.com, and then information about each of the N most recent articles. In Ask Leo's case, I think it's the 10 most recent articles. There actually is no definition of how many recent articles should be included. I know of some sites that include only the single most recent article, and I know of others that include 20, 30, 50, or more. The point is that these are the most recent articles, most recent one being shown or listed first. So what can you do with an RSS feed? Because obviously it's not really that interesting to look at by itself. What you end up doing is called subscribing to a feed. And in order to subscribe to a feed, you use a tool called a feed reader. Now, there have been in the past some very cool feed readers that have fallen by the wayside, just because RSS feeds never really went as mainstream as so many of us hoped they would. But that doesn't mean that there aren't good solutions out there right now. I happen to use a feed reader called Feedly. And what you do with a feed reader is you say, I would like to subscribe to, and then either give it the site, askleo.com, or if you have the feed URL, like we just saw, askleo.com/feed, you can give it the feed URL, and then Feedly will grab whatever's in that RSS feed and show it to you. And it'll manage your own personal read/unread state. So it becomes a way of reading all of the messages that are in that RSS feed under your own terms, as you want to. When a new article is published on Ask Leo, the feed is updated. The feed reader, which eventually comes around and pulls and asks for an updated copy of the feed, says, hey, there's a new article here, and it shows it up as unread to your subscription using the reader. So what makes RSS so useful? Well, it's another way to collect information from a variety of websites all over the place and put it all in one place. So I've got subscriptions to like a couple of hundred different websites in my Feedly, and that allows me to, in this one place, know whenever something new has been published on any one of those sites. It's not email. It's not subject to spam. This was one of the big things that caused a lot of people to really believe RSS would succeed where email newsletters had not. It didn't turn out that way, but the fact is, RSS feeds are not spam. You choose what you subscribe to. You get nothing else. That's actually kind of nice. You control your subscriptions. So, for example, if a feed suddenly becomes uninteresting to you, if your interest has waned, you can unsubscribe to it and it just goes away. There's no downside. In fact, there's a very good possibility that the person providing the feed would never know because there's really no notification mechanism. One day you're pulling the feed from the site into your reader and the next day you're not because you're not interested in it anymore. It's mostly anonymous. In other words, the feed reader goes out and gets the information for you and identifies itself as, say, Feedly. But the fact that you are subscribed to it, that you are picking up information from that particular site, probably doesn't make it through. That doesn't mean that it can't be discovered and it can't be figured out. And for all I know, it's very possible that law enforcement could force it to be taken because, of course, Feedly knows that you're subscribed to this feed. And even though that information may never leave Feedly, maybe they could be compelled. I don't know. But the point is that by its architecture, there really is no identification mechanism built into it, unlike email. So how do you know if a site offers RSS? Well, sometimes you just don't. Sometimes you have to guess. Do look for the RSS icon. Here's a picture of it. I used it in the article. You'll usually find it somewhere on a homepage. That is usually linked to the site's RSS feed. Also look for links that say subscribe in RSS. Look for the phrase RSS. Sometimes sites will include explicit links somewhere on the page, maybe in the footer, maybe somewhere else, depending on just how much they've truly embraced RSS as a delivery technology. However, sometimes the sites don't even know that they're providing an RSS feed, which I find kind of funny. The reason for that is, as I said earlier, when you implement a site in WordPress, the software that drives something like a third of the websites on the internet, WordPress provides a feed by default. Now, there are different ways to deal with that knowledge. One is, okay, just try whatever site.com or .whatever slash feed and see if something comes up. If it does, you've discovered the RSS feed for that site. On the other hand, it's not always called feed, and sometimes it's called other things, and sometimes there are multiple feeds for different things. A good way to figure out what it is you want? Feedly. If you go to Feedly and just enter the base URL of a site when you go to add a feed, Feedly will go out and query. There are mechanisms in place that would allow Feedly to determine which feeds are available at that URL and then show them to you and let you choose not only which one, if there's more than one, but whether or not this is the feed you're really looking for. In some cases, there just may not be a feed, and there's really nothing you can do about that. It's unfortunate, other than perhaps lobby the site owner to create one. But hopefully by now, you've gotten an idea of how useful getting all this information aggregated into a single place for your consumption really can be. It beats the heck out of trying to remember to go visit all these sites to see if they've got something new. Instead, just visit your RSS reader every so often, and it'll show you. I hope this is helpful. I hope you find something interesting out of this technology. It's been pretty life-changing for me in terms of all the information that I try to consume online. For updates, for related links, for examples, for comments, and more, visit askleo.com/138065. I'm Leo Notenboom. This is askleo.com. Thanks for watching.